Hello and welcome. In this 12th video of this series, we are going to discuss one of the most important, at the same time, one of the most rewarding areas of botany syllabus. Yes, we are talking about plant physiology and biochemistry. This area finds a place in paper 2 of both IFS and civil service syllabus. It is one of the biggest areas in the syllabus. It is going to take some time to cover it well, but at the same time, its weightage is approximately 1/3 of the total botany paper 2. So the time and energy is spent in this area is going to be well worth your effort. Apart from that, it is going to be a very interesting journey, provided you have the right approach and you have been guided about the right book to study this area. As always, in the end, I am going to discuss what are the best resources for this area, and certainly this entire discussion, like the rest of the discussion of the series, is going to be based on a good analysis of the last 15 years of question paper. So let us take a look on the importance of this area in the civil service main and IFS main syllabus in the last 15 years. So if you look at it, this is the overall weightage that paper 2 divides among the major topics. So physiology is the orange area here, and this gets 32% of overall weightage. So it is approximately 1/3 of paper 2, and this should be getting nearly 25% of your paper 2 effort. So whatever time you are going to spend in paper 2 preparation, approximately 1/4 of your time will be taken by physiology, but that is a realistic amount of time to give to physiology. And if you give that much time, it will give you a level of proficiency in plant physiology and biochemistry, which will make you score very, very well in this area. Let's take a look on the syllabus. First, I am giving you the unprocessed syllabus, the way UPSC gives it. So when you read the UPSC notification in the employment news or from any of the website, this is a long paragraph, topic separated by comma and semicolons, and this is a long list of topic. Certainly a lot of topics which are related are placed far away from each other, and at the same time some seemingly unrelated topics have been brought close together. So this is not going to be an ideal way to do this area. We are going to break topic according to their relation with each other, and we are also going to organize it in a manner that gives you a good coherent concept. There are certain topics which must be done before certain other topics. So it is in that order I have organized the entire syllabus, and we are going to discuss it. Now, the first topic in plant physiology is plant-water relation. So when we deal with plant-water relation, there are several subtopics, and each subtopic that you see on the screen right now are important for a standalone short note. The first one is SPAC. SPAC stands for soil, plant, atmosphere, continuum. It is in this continuum the entire plant-water relation operates, and this is where the processes like uptake of water, ascent of sap, and transpiration, these three processes operate. So when you are writing on SPAC, your focus should be on what is the SPAC made up of, what role does SPAC have in overall plant-water relation, and then what are the major processes of SPAC. That should be one short note you must be prepared with. Another foundational topic which is not mentioned in the syllabus, but of course it has been asked in the examination, is water potential. So water potential explains why water moves from point A to point B within a SPAC part. So from within the soil, if water is moving from one point to another, or from soil water moves into the plant, then also then from within the plant, from the root water moves into the aerial parts, and from the aerial parts of the plant water escapes in the vapor form in the atmosphere. All of these are manifestation of movement of water, and all of them are governed by nothing but water potential relation. The underlying fact is that water will be moving from a place of its high potential to a place of its lower potential. What are the factors which contribute to water potential? That you have to study. For example, pressure is one of the factors, presence of solutes, presence of metrical material, and height of the body where we are going to analyze the water's potential. So all of these factors contribute to water potential, and they have a significant bearing on plant water relation. Then there are certain SPAC processes that you need to know about. To be precise, you have got four SPAC processes in your syllabus: transpiration, stomatal mechanism, uptake of water, and ascent of sap. Let's discuss them one after one. First and foremost, transpiration. So transpiration is nothing but escape of water from a naturally occurring pore from the plant body into the atmosphere in the vapor form. That's what transpiration is. There are three types of transpiration. You have stomatal, you have cuticular, and you have lenticular transpiration. In this short note, you need to include what is transpiration, what are the major types of transpiration, what is their relative weightage within the overall scenario of transpiration, and finally, the mechanism of transpiration, especially the mechanism of stomatal transpiration. And that is exactly where you also have to deal with stomatal mechanism. Stomatal mechanism basically deals with why do stomata open, and why do the stomata get closed. So of course it is a hydrostatic state driven process, but what causes turgidity within the guard cells and what causes the guard cells to go flaccid? So many theories have been proposed, but my suggestion is that do not write all the theories. You neither have the time nor do you have the space in your answer sheet to write all the theories. More importantly, many of those theories are now outdated, so there is no need to write. What you can actually do here is that you should be writing the most recent and currently accepted theory, which is based on the blue light receptor zeaxanthin, how blue light is received by zeaxanthin, and what kind of signal cascade zeaxanthin initiates, at the end of which not only the guard cells become turgid, but also their wall becomes a little elastic. So stomatal mechanism should be studied in detail, and my suggestion is that it should be prepared as a separate short note. And within the transpiration, a very small outline of a stomatal mechanism need to be given. But when you are writing a separate short note on a stomatal mechanism, then you will need to write a little more upon stomatal mechanism. Therefore, you need to study this in detail. Next one is uptake of water. In uptake of water, you have to deal with how does soil water move into the plant root. In this, you will be coming across the zone of absorption, its functional anatomy within the root, and you will also be dealing with symplastic and apoplastic space, and how does water move from the root to plant xylem, and from plant xylem how it is sent to the aerial parts. All of this within uptake of water. And lastly, you will be dealing with ascent of sap. So ascent of sap basically deals with that the water that root has taken up from the soil, how does that water move from underground part of the plant to the aerial part of the plant. In this regard, you have a very important theory, that is cohesion tension theory, or CTT, given by Dixon and Jolly. So this theory needs to be explained in detail. What were the basic proposals of this theory? What are the properties of xylem as a tissue which makes it ideal to carry water across the long distance? And last but not the least, what are the properties of water itself which allows it to go such long distance even under such tremendous tension? And finally, you will be writing about evidences of cohesion tension hypothesis. So these are the main topics, subtopics which you have to deal in plant water relation. Then you will move to the next topic, and the next topic is mineral nutrition. Mineral nutrition is seemingly a small topic, but it is not, because here you will need to deal with all the essential elements for plant nutrition, their available form within the soil, and how the plant makes use of this element within its physiology or its structure. And finally, you are going to deal with what will happen to a plant if the plant becomes deficient for that particular element. So in this, what you have to do is first the role of minerals. So in role of minerals, it is totally a factual part where you are going to deal with what role a particular mineral plays in the plant's physiology or structure. There are certain minerals which are important from structural point of view. There are certain minerals which are important from metabolic point of view, and then there are certain which are important from both the aspects. And within the role itself, I would suggest that the third point that you have got on your board, that is mineral deficiency, you should also be remembering the mineral deficiency. There are certain deficiencies which will appear similar to other elements deficiency. There you will need to pay a little careful attention on how two different deficiencies will still be demarcated. So there are certain finer points where you have to pay attention. Criteria of essentiality is going to be an important thing. It was given by Arnon and Stout, and then from time to time there have been modifications in criteria of essentiality. So as of now, there are at least four, in some books there are five essentiality establishing criteria. So all of those need to be known to you so that you can include them while you are describing what makes an essential element. And finally, the process part, how elements are taken from soil solution into the plant body. This is proper physiology. Here you need to understand the modern concept of apparent free space, or AFS. Unfortunately, this is not given in any of the Indian textbook that I have come across, and that is exactly why in plant physiology I am going to recommend you only one international author book, and I have not made any recommendation for any Indian book, because plant physiology is one area where questions are fairly current in their approach. By current, I mean what is available in the current textbooks, and that is not going to be nicely served when you rely on traditional Indian textbooks. So what I'm trying to say is that when you are dealing with the process of mineral uptake, you will need to know the cationic exchange theory, you will need to know the concept of apparent free space, you will need to know which element gets absorbed or taken up by what part of the root, and what kind of combination of active and passive process are engaged in the overall uptake of minerals. So all of these need to be done in mineral nutrition. Next topic is going to be mechanism of phloem transport. This is truly a small topic, and mostly there is a direct question being asked on phloem transport, and to that direct question, these are the subheadings that you need to know. First and foremost, why there is a need for phloem transport, why a separate tissue phloem, why alone xylem cannot bring about all the long distance transports required by the plant. So the neat part needs to be done well. Then getting information from plant anatomy, you again need to touch upon the structure of phloem as a conducting tissue, and then you will come to the principles of phloem transport. When we talk about the principles of phloem transport, what we are meaning here is that in xylem, the substances move from one point to another by using a negative pressure, that is by using a pulling force. But in phloem, the substances move from one place to another under positive pressure. And this is also known as प्रेशर फ्लो हाइपोथेसिस। After that, you will be doing stages of phloem transport, where you are going to deal with loading of phloem at source. Second is translocation within phloem network, and last is unloading. So these are the three stages. You need to explain all the three stages, and finally you should be explaining the pressure flow hypothesis in some good detail, so that you have touched everything sufficiently. So that's a small topic. So taken together, plant water relation, mineral uptake and translocation, and phloem physiology, taken together, these three topics cover the entire physiology of transport within the plant. After this, we come to plant metabolism, where we will be dealing with photosynthesis, respiration, nitrogen metabolism, lipid metabolism, and also certain smaller topics such as coenzymes. Enzyme is also going to be a topic, but that's a little big topic. Let's see what all is there. Photosynthesis. So two biggest topics in plant physiology is photosynthesis and respiration. Within these topics, there are so many subtopics. Every single topic is important as a standalone question in the examination, and then there are certain questions which can be asked from inside photosynthesis light stage, inside photosynthesis dark stage, so on. So these are the topics where we need to really prepare very well. First and foremost, get to know all the basics very well. So what is photosynthesis? Next is stages of photosynthesis, role of chlorophyll. After you have done all of this, the first topic is photochemical reactions. This is nothing but light dependent stage of photosynthesis. Do it very, very well. Direct question have been asked so many times. That is one thing. Next, pigments as photoreceptors. So this is a separately mentioned topic in our syllabus, pigments as photoreceptors. But here I am dividing it into two parts. One is plastidial pigment that you should ideally be doing along with photosynthesis, and then non-plastidial pigment that you will be doing later before flowering. So here you are going to deal with plastidial pigments, essentially speaking, chlorophylls, carotenoids, and phycobilins. So these are the three things that you need to do. In chlorophyll, all the variants of chlorophyll you should be doing. In carotenoids, so you'll be doing carotenes and xanthophylls, and then phycobilins, both the types, phycoerythrin and phycocyanin. What is the basic difference? Where are they found? What is their role? So on. Within the light reaction, you should be preparing photophosphorylation as a separate topic. Photophosphorylation is nothing but ATP synthesis simultaneous to photosynthetic light reaction. For this, chloroplast thylakoid membrane have got ATP synthase complexes. These ATP synthase complexes are very, very similar to mitochondrial ATP synthase complexes. The only major way in which photophosphorylation differs from oxidative phosphorylation that happens in the mitochondria is the generation of high energy electrons. So generation of high energy electrons in photophosphorylation occurs by photochemical reactions, whereas there it is by oxidative reactions which happen upon NADH and FADH2. Similarly, how proton gradient is developed is also different between photophosphorylation and oxidative phosphorylation. And because of these fundamental differences, in the past also, questions have been asked to differentiate between photophosphorylation and oxidative phosphorylation. It's not a difficult question. If you have prepared well, you will be easily answering this question. But my suggestion is that prepare it as a standalone question. Next, you will be coming to the dark reaction, and within the dark reaction, the first thing that you should be doing is the C3 pathway. C3 pathway is nothing but Calvin cycle. It's a long cycle. It will require you to very slowly understand each step and the logic behind the individual steps of Calvin cycle, and then you will need to remember it very, very well, because it is perhaps the most important part of photosynthesis. You need to remember it with proper enzymology. Once you have done that, you need to do photorespiration. Photorespiration is also known as the PCO pathway, that is photosynthetic carbon oxidation pathway. This is also known as C2 pathway. So get into the details of photorespiration, each reaction, proper enzymes, and what purpose does photorespiration play, and what is the detrimental aspect of photorespiration, all of this. Finally, the mechanism to increase the efficiency of Calvin cycle, especially under the hot conditions. And there are two mechanisms. One is C4 pathway, and second is crassulacean acid metabolism, that is CAM pathway. You need to do both of them very, very well. So these are individual topics and subtopics that you ought to be doing in photosynthesis. But you should understand that there hardly goes a year in the civil service main examination when one question is not asked from photosynthesis or respiration. So when you have done all the subtopics of photosynthesis and respiration, you can be very sure of one question in paper 2 physiology section. Next topic is, of course, respiration. Respiration is again as big a topic as photosynthesis. Here the main dimensions of respiration is going to be aerobic as well as anaerobic. Aerobic pathway is longer, so in aerobic pathway, first and foremost, you will do glycolysis, then PDH reaction. PDH means pyruvate dehydrogenase reaction, then TCA pathway, and after TCA pathway, you need to know what is the mitochondrial electron transport chain like, what are the four major complexes which this respiratory electron transport chain made up of, each complex, what are the subcomponents of this complex, that also you need to know, especially what are the redox centers inside each complex. After knowing the structure of the respiratory electron transport, you will also need to know the flow of electron within this respiratory electron transport chain. Once you are done with this, you will know how proton gradient is generated between the two membranes of the mitochondria. And it is these protons which eventually drive the chemiosmotic synthesis of ATP. That will be the subject of the next topic, that is oxidative phosphorylation and chemiosmotic theory. Once you are done with all of this, that means you are completely done with aerobic part of respiration. Now you will be paying attention to anaerobic part of respiration, where after glycolysis, pyruvic acid is utilized without any direct engagement of molecular oxygen. So this is called fermentation, and there are two types of fermentation that you see. First is acidic fermentation, where pyruvic acid is converted into lactic acid, and second is alcohol fermentation, where first pyruvic acid goes through loss of a carbon dioxide molecule, that is called decarboxylation. After that, acetaldehyde is formed, and then acetaldehyde is reduced into ethanol, that is called alcohol fermentation. So both alcohol fermentation as well as acid fermentation need to be studied by you, and at the same time you also need to know what are the industrial applications of these fermentive processes. Once you are done with all of this, general overview of energy transfer at each step and how energy is conserved by cells at each step, that you need to pay attention to. So more or less the last topic is a review of the entire respiratory pathway from the energy aspect. So this is photosynthesis and then respiration, two of the biggest topics. After that, we will come to lipid metabolism. Lipid metabolism is relatively a smaller topic. First, you need to know what are the types of lipids in the plant, then how fatty acids are synthesized within the plant, then beta oxidation of fatty acids within the plant, where does beta oxidation take place, and certainly it is different from the animals. And after lipid synthesis and beta oxidation, there is a unique pathway that takes place only in plants, that is glyoxylate pathway. So glyoxylate pathway takes place in modified peroxisomes, which are known as glyoxysome, and this is the pathway by which plants convert their stored oils into sugars. So in a way it is a gluconeogenetic pathway, where stored oils first go through hydrolysis, then the fatty acids go through beta oxidation. Beta oxidation generates acetyl groups in the form of acetyl CoA, that goes through glyoxylate pathway, and the glyoxylate pathway will be generating intermediates which will be participating in gluconeogenesis and which will help the plant tissue form sugars necessary for generation of germination of seeds. So that is how glyoxylate pathway is very, very significant. Direct as well as indirect questions have been asked on glyoxylate pathway. Direct question will be directly asking what is glyoxylate pathway, explain it and mention its significance. Indirect question is, with suitable biochemical pathways, explain the germination of an oil seeds. So when the examiner is asking you explain the germination of oil seed, examiner is basically wanting to know that oil seeds which store oil in their endosperm, how is this oil converted into sugar before the seed germinates. So essentially this is not a question on seed germination, it is a question on glyoxylate pathway. Next topic is nitrogen fixation and nitrogen metabolism. First and foremost, you will be doing forms of nitrogen available to plants. So plants have got ammonia or ammonium ion available, but not under most of the cases. So under most of the cases, plants use nitrate. So under what conditions plant have got ammonia or ammonium ions available, and under what condition the plants have got nitrate available, that you have to know clearly. Next is nitrogen assimilation by plants. So most of the cases plants assimilate nitrogen in the form of nitrate. They convert it into nitrite, and nitrite is reduced into ammonium, and then ammonium is attached to organic skeleton, and that you get amino acids. Then these amino acids will be participating in transamination reactions. So all of this you need to do. Next, nitrogen fixation you have to do. Nitrogen fixation converts diatomic molecular nitrogen into two molecules of ammonia. Of course, it is an energy consuming reduction reaction that takes place. This process can take place within the biological system only by certain bacteria. There is no eukaryote which has got the capacity to fix atmospheric nitrogen, and only a few bacteria are capable of doing it, and these bacteria are called diazotrophic bacteria. These bacteria can be symbiotic to plants, for example Rhizobium, Azorhizobium, Cynorhizobium, Bradyrhizobium. They form symbiotic association with various leguminous plants, and at the same time there are a number of cyanobacteria, the blue-green algae, Nostoc, Anabina, which are nitrogen fixing, plus there are certain eubacteria also, which apart from Rhizobium and related genera, which can fix nitrogen. Some of them are symbiotic, some of them are free living. The biochemical pathway is identical whether the nitrogen fixation takes place symbiotically or non-symbiotically. And with respect to symbiotic nitrogen fixation, you also have to mention what are the steps in establishment of symbiosis. So that also needs to be explained well in your short note, because once in a while a question can be asked even on this aspect. Now slowly we are also coming to an end of metabolic and biochemical physiology, but not before we have touched one of the big topics, that is enzymes and coenzymes. So in the syllabus only enzymes and coenzymes is mentioned, but it is a little vague. You have to study a number of subtopics, and all the subtopics that you ought to be studying, I have mentioned it here. So first and foremost, start with what is an enzyme, what does it mean to be catalyst in biological context, what are the major types of enzymes according to Enzyme Commission of International Union of Biochemists, what is the classification, and what are the rules of enzyme nomenclature. The enzyme nomenclature rules have been laid down by Enzyme Commission way back in 1960s. You need to mention that. After that, what are the characters, what are the properties of an enzyme? You need to prepare a list of it. Next part will be structure of enzymes. So how the enzymes are structured, what is their three-dimensional, what are their major three-dimensional domains, and last but not the least, the active sites of enzyme need to be done really well. After this, mechanism of enzyme action. It will start with enzyme binding to the substrate. The binding to the substrate can be through lock and key, through induced fit, or through hybrid fit. But it does not stop there. After that, you have to deal with what happens between an enzyme and the substrate so that catalysis happens. So this is called catalytic strategies. Catalysis by acid-base mechanism, catalysis by ion exchange mechanism, catalysis by covalent modification. So there are a number of catalytic strategies. Some of them are even mechanical, like catalysis by torsion, catalysis by approximation. All of these mechanisms will also come under the same heading, mechanism of enzyme action. And last but not the least, the enzyme kinetic aspects also come under mechanism of enzyme action, where you will be dealing with Michaelis-Menten equation, Michaelis-Menten's curve of enzyme action, and you will need to clearly mention the activation energy and enzyme saturation concept. So all of these will come under mechanism of enzyme action. Then you should deal with enzyme inhibition, the irreversible and reversible, and within reversible, competitive inhibition, non-competitive inhibition, and uncompetitive inhibition. So all of these you need to deal nicely. Then enzyme regulation. So enzyme regulation will again be subdivided into pre-translational regulation. That will be enzyme regulation at the level of the gene which encodes enzyme, and then post-translational regulation. Once enzyme has been synthesized, what are the mechanisms of regulation which are available, like feedback regulation, compartmentalization, allostery, covalent modification. So these are some of the mechanisms by which enzymes are regulated. Then you will need to deal with coenzymes. Before studying coenzyme, you should be broadening the horizon a little, and you should be first understanding the term cofactor. What's an enzymatic cofactor? What are the major types of cofactor? And within the cofactor, how coenzymes are placed? So you have to deal with that, and then Rest of the answer can deal with coenzymes. What are their major types? How do the coenzymes work? And how do the coenzymes help in catalysis by the enzymes? Once you have done all of this, please also do applications of enzymes. Once in a while, application has also been asked. So do applications of enzymes. And after doing all of this, you will be completely done with enzymes, and not only enzymes, the entire biochemical physiology. So just to take a look, what all did we have to study in biochemical physiology? We studied photosynthesis. We studied all the topics related to respiration, then lipid metabolism, nitrogen metabolism, enzymes and coenzymes. Rest of the physiology is called physiology of development and environmental physiology, because in the rest of the topics you are going to see that plant is going through some sort of phase transition. A vegetative plant becomes reproductive, it forms the flower and all that. Similarly, a reproductive phase plant turns senescent, that means it will turn old and it will die. Similarly, you will see a seed that has just now been formed, it will go through dormancy, and a dormant seed will eventually come out of dormancy and it will be germinating. So you are noticing that the phase of the plant is going through a change, that is called phase transition, hence developmental physiology. But one of the most important aspects of developmental physiology of plant is that the plant development events are closely correlated to environmental variations. Flowering is related to temperature and day period, photo period conditions. Similarly, to an extent, seed germination is also related to available light and very certainly available oxygen and moisture. So this last part is environmental and developmental physiology, and the very first topic is growth substances. These are plant hormones which we have to study. Traditionally, five plant hormones have been studied: auxins, gibberellins, cytokinins, ethylene and abscisic acid. But nowadays, given the importance brassinosteroids have been receiving, I would be suggesting that you should also be adding brassinosteroid in your overall coverage. So within plant hormones, what are the things that you should be studying? First and foremost, chemical nature, mechanism of action, role, and then application in agrohorticulture. Mechanism of action will mean you need to know the signaling pathway. Role means physiological effects. Chemical nature is self-obvious, and application in agrohorticulture is also self-obvious, but auxins and ethylene, for these you should also do synthesis. Synthesis of these two hormones should be studied, and it will be helping you one day in handling some unexpected question. For rest of the hormones, you have to discuss only chemical nature, mechanism of action, role and applications. But I must be saying that each hormone should be treated as a separate chapter. Auxin is one chapter, gibberellin is another chapter, cytokinins is another, abscisic acid, ethylene, brassinosteroid is another chapter, because the questions are asked a little deep in plant growth substances and you need to treat it accordingly. Once you are done with this, you will be dealing with pigments as photoreceptor, part 2. Part 1 we have already done as plastidial pigment. Part 2 are those pigments which are important photomorphogenetically. Means they mediate such responses of plants where some sort of morphogenesis is happening, which is induced by light. And there are three pigments that you have to deal with. One of the best studied pigment is phytochrome. So many questions have been asked on phytochrome in the past. So this is something which has to be done in most detailed form. And these two are only for short note. Phototropins, and phototropins primarily mediate the phototropic bending of shoot axis, but at the same time you have other roles of phototropin, and in some plants it is the phototropins which mediate the estomatal response, and in some it is zeaxanthin which mediates the estomatal response. And then you also have to do cryptochromes. Cryptochromes are also blue light receptor, and they have a supplementary role in flowering response. Flowering response is primarily controlled by phytochrome, and then cryptochromes have a supplementary role here. Do these photopigments as receptors, and then you can move to physiology of flowering, fruit physiology, seed physiology, etc. So the next topic is physiology of flowering. Photoperiodism is a chapter in itself. What is photoperiodism? What are the major types of photoperiodic plants? Each photoperiodic type needs to be explained clearly by you with proper examples. Then what is the physiological basis of photoperiodic response? Now the scientists have very clearly been able to identify what is the mechanism, underlying mechanism for short day plant, and what is the underlying mechanism for a long day plant. When you are reading a good book, which I am going to suggest towards the end of the discussion, you will be able to handle photoperiodism very, very well in the light of most current understanding. After that, what is the role very low temperature plays in the flowering of some plants, especially the plants which are native to temperate parts of the world? This effect is called vernalization, where flowering won't occur if the plant at some developmental stage has not been exposed to some excessively low temperature. So that's what we are going to see, vernalization, and ultimately we are going to see physiology of flowering. How photoperiodic effect, how vernalizing effect, how do they combine to initiate a cascade of gene action which eventually leads to proper flowering. So all of this you have to study well under flowering, and after flowering you will be moving to fruit physiology. Generally, fruit physiology gives you only a direct question, the mechanism of fruit ripening, but in my opinion you should be doing these subheadings under fruit physiology. First and foremost, stages of fruit development. So what is the formative stage, what is the early growth, what is the second growth phase, then finally what is the ripening stage. Then fruit ripening and its types. There are two basic types, climacteric and non-climacteric. Give examples, give their characteristics and all. Then hormonal and biochemical basis of fruit ripening. What changes biochemically when a fruit goes on to ripen, and what changes hormonally? Molecular basis of fruit ripening, what are the genes, etc., which are responsible for ripening of fruit? And finally, manipulation of fruit ripening. This is a repeat from previous topic, you can ignore that. So manipulation means sometimes it is advisable to delay the fruit ripening, sometimes people want to speed up the fruit ripening, of course for commercial gains, but these are some of the standard practices. How do we accomplish that? That you have to know, and you as always you have to give proper examples for this. Next is seed physiology. In seed physiology, stages of seed development, then seed dormancy and its types. Then you will be dealing with hormonal and biochemical basis of dormancy and mechanisms to overcome dormancy. All that I am ticking is a short note. So until now, four separate short notes you have seen. Then seed germination is another short note here. Storage of seeds is another short note here. So within seed physiology you have to deal with these topics. After this you will be coming to stress physiology. Within stress physiology, first and foremost you should equip yourself with the basic terms related to plant stress. So what's a plant stress? What is biotic stress? What is abiotic stress? Within abiotic stress, what are the nutrient stresses and what are the other environmental stresses? Then the plant's response, the strain. What is elastic strain? What is plastic strain? What is plant injury? What is the meaning of mitigation? What is the meaning of avoidance, all of these terms have got a proper technical meaning. You have to pay attention to them. After that, there are four clear-cut stresses given by your syllabus. All of these stresses you have to study: heat stress, drought stress, salinity stress, and heavy metal stress. Study each stress under these headings. First, a statement of the stress. When do we consider a plant is suffering heat stress? Then, impact on the plant, mechanism of that impact, means how does plant get impacted, what is the physiological basis of that impact. Then, plant's avoidance strategy, plant's coping mechanism, and finally, human intervention to mitigate the injury. So, under these headings, all these four stresses you need to do. After stress physiology, you have to do four minor topics which are mentioned in the syllabus. Each minor topic should be prepared like a short note. These are the minor topics. Growth indices, very less asked, very less. 10 years, not even once, but sometimes it can pop up. So growth indices, you should be preparing a short note on that. Plant movement is an interesting topic, but it has not been asked much in the examination. So I would say just prepare it sufficiently. If plant movement general short note is asked, you are able to handle it. And so far as phototropic and gravitropic movement is concerned, you would have already studied it under auxin responses. So I'm not including two major plant movements, phototropic and gravitropic, because they are part of auxin responses. Senescence is turning old and eventual death of the plant or plant part. You need to do it. And lastly, importance of secondary metabolites and what role do they play in plant defenses. So these are the four minor topics. Individually, if you prepare a short note on these minor topics, you are completely safe, and that will bring plant physiology to an end. So you would have realized that plant physiology is a big topic, and if you really sit down to cover plant physiology nicely, it will take you some time. But given the fact that it acquires 1/3 weightage in paper 2, whatever time that you spend, it will be approximately 1/4 of your entire paper 2 effort, which will be quite justified. Above all, it is a very rewarding area. If you write your answer nicely with diagrams, flowchart, examiner does not hesitate in giving you good marks. But your concepts, your facts should be updated, and that brings me to the best sources. One is Fundamentals of Plant Physiology, written at a little basic level but excellently written by Lincoln Tays, Eduardo Zeiger, and now two more authors, Moller and Murphy. And Plant Physiology and Development is slightly more detailed by the same authors, same four authors. So any one of them is a world-class textbook. And when you study from these books, there is no topic of your syllabus which is not adequately done. If you want to kind of save time and effort and want to rely on one compiled version of coverage, then you can go for my study material on plant physiology and biochemistry. I have recently, in 2020, I have updated this. So it is based on these books plus certain other books and fairly updated. But the choice is entirely yours. So that brings us to an end of plant physiology discussion. It is now your turn to start preparing plant physiology, and hopefully you have already completed your genetics. And very soon I'll be coming up with a short video on plant breeding and biotechnology. So once you have completed genetics, plant breeding, biotechnology, and plant physiology, you would have done almost 70% of your botany paper too, because apart from these, what you are left with is cell bio and then ecology and plant geography. So now gear up and start preparing plant physiology and biochemistry, and it will be highly rewarding. Till we meet again, goodbye and good luck to all of you, and thank you for being here.